Hello, everybody. Welcome back. Another Thursday night with Color Outside the Lines. I'm Kate Good, and I'm joined by my co-host, Melissa D. White. Hi, Melissa.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back. Ready for this conversation?
Yes, it's going to be a good one. And of course, Amanda Macklin. Hello, Amanda.
Hey, everybody. How are you?
Doing well. Y'all are looking mighty spiffy today. Just going to compliment the fashion. I like it. Well, here we are for our next broadcast of Color Outside the Lines. And so many of you continue to join us on this journey, and that started exactly 30 days ago with the murder of George Floyd. And boy, we have seen so much happen in our world, in our nation, in our industry, in our own personal lives, and right here on this broadcast. It's been a journey of conversation that isn't always the easiest to have. But we've all been very courageous, and we continue to seek to create a very safe place to have these conversations, support one another, always maintain a level of love and friendship, and with the same goal of advancing our agenda for equality in all that we do, in all that we touch, in all that we seek. And so today we've got a really exciting episode that we can't wait to get to. So with that, I welcome you to Color Outside the Lines.
All right, let's get started. We got a lot to cover tonight. So first things first, last week we introduced good news. So we're going to get there in a minute. But just a quick show update. So the last two shows, Melissa and Kate, have had over 11,100 full views, meaning people have watched our entire show. We have reached almost 23,000 people. We've had 750 comments, and over 100 people have shared our broadcast. So big news, which it's interesting because my the owner of my company says one person may not be able to change the world, but we can't change the whole world, but we can change one person. And I think we're doing it one person at a time. And we're doing some topics that aren't easy to talk about. So
let's invite our audience to all share the broadcast right now and help us to share this. Right now, grab your phone, your tablet, whatever you're working on, hit share, send this to your Facebook wall, and let's expand our reach and just see how many people we can get on our broadcast tonight. We'd love to see everybody's comments. Your comments mean a lot to us. We love to have you be a part of this broadcast.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. That's amazing news. And thank you guys, because you keep showing up to have these conversations. The feedback that we've received is amazing, that you are tuning in with your families during dinner time, and that you're returning back to your jobs and your teams to actually use this as a jogger for good dialogue. Thank you guys.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I'm going to start with good news. I was going through, we've had people write into us, tell us what they're doing at our companies. I attended my first committee at my company today. So that was really inspiring. Over 20 people joined our committee to make a difference in our company and then in the surrounding areas where we have offices. But one of the things that stood out to me, I live in Indiana, but my daughter's in the state of Georgia, and finally passed a hate crime bill on the 23rd of, I guess that was Tuesday.
Yes.
Long time coming, long, long time coming. And I'm really excited to celebrate that activism and people not giving up got that push through. So yay, Georgia.
Wow.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, in that, I think that mine would be definitely Breonna Taylor. We're seeing some wins. I mean, I know there's a lot of controversy over the protest and, you know, the way things were happening, but we have to admit that the collective voice of the people does matter. It does move the needle when we show up, and we have to celebrate the big and the small wins. One of those is out of Louisville, Kentucky. If you're not familiar with the shooting death of Breonna Taylor, Breonna is a 26-year-old EMT. There's a no-knock warrant issued, it was the wrong house, and was killed in a police shooting. It's been 3 months since her death, and there was an arrest of an officer, Brett Hankison, and that's, I mean, not an arrest, but he's fired. I'm sorry. I want to get that right. And I know some people are like, well, okay, he was fired, but it's not enough. But considering that it has taken this long to see some type of movement, you know, we're just celebrating something. So just continue to show up, sign the petitions, make the calls, do what you need to do.
Absolutely.
My good news for this week comes from the Council of Fashion Designers of America, CFDA. And the reason why I'm spotlighting it is because the fashion industry is traditionally very white. You don't see a lot of representation from minorities in the fashion industry. And they're the first to admit it. And so they have taken a bold step. On June 2nd, they had a board meeting and unanimously approved 4 steps that I think will serve as an example for companies and industry associations. They are an industry association. They lead their industry, and Tom Ford's their president. And let's just say he's fun to look at too. So I was paying attention, but there's really 4 pillars that they're enacting. One is to have an in-house employment program to promote Black talent within the fashion business and seek to have racial balance in all of their activities. Number 2 was to create a very focused mentoring program to really lift up people with talent who are interested in the industry, both from a design side, business side. And then number 3 is to have diversity and inclusion training programs. And they're going to be creating those programs and then allowing all their members to access them, participate in them at no charge. And then finally, raising funds to contribute to programs that seek to level the playing field in their industry. So CFDA, I think, has really made a great example that I think our industry, businesses in our industry, need to take a look at it. And certainly all the associations that support our industry should be looking at something too. So good news there, good examples from CFDA.
Yeah, I think the other thing too is so many of us on this call are from the multifamily industry, and sometimes we're a little slow to get things going, but these other industries like the fashion industry, MLS, changing, they're no longer using master bedroom, master bath anymore. There's lots of things coming out that of industries making change. And I think that the NAA and our multifamily family is going to follow suit soon. So with that being said, we are going to watch a quick video. If you guys know me, I use humor a lot because sometimes when things are uncomfortable, I need something to laugh at. It could be the biggest sarcastic video, any of that. But we're going to play a video from one of my favorites, James Corden, who had a conversation about white privilege. And I'll be honest with you, when I watched it, I'm like, that is me. Like, that is me. So, Melissa, I'll have you roll that video. And as soon as we roll that video, when we're done, we're going to introduce our subject matter experts and we're going to get rolling.
What do you mean? What tools do I have?
Actually, the tool that you have is so powerful, you're probably not even aware of it.
Is it? Oh, there's no, I don't want this to come out as arrogant. Is it my charisma? Because people say that. They say that about me. They say I've got a sort of, they can't put their finger on it. Do you know what I mean? I've got a sort of vulnerable confidence you rarely find in a big man.
It's your privilege. That's what it is. I shouldn't have made you guess.
Privilege. My privilege. Right. Right. Let's pretend as an exercise that I don't 100% know what that means, but I do know that when I hear it, it makes me feel bad.
It's perfectly normal to feel a little bit guilty talking about privilege. But if it helps, having privilege isn't your fault. It's something you inherited, not something you did wrong.
Ah, no. Well, that's the thing, you see. This is, no, I didn't inherit anything. Like, I didn't grow up in a wealthy home. Do you know what I mean? We used to go camping in Bournemouth. You know, I'm not privileged in any way.
I'm so happy you brought that up. One of the biggest misconceptions about privilege is that saying you have it is saying you have an easy life or that you had it easy growing up. It doesn't mean that. What privilege does mean, specifically white privilege, is that your skin color didn't make your life more challenging.
Right, I hear what you're saying, but the thought that I have white privilege makes me feel really bad.
It doesn't
have I to. Feel bad.
It's okay.
It's made me, I'm feeling bad. Oh, I hate racism. I hate racism.
Let's try to keep going.
But I have white privilege. Yeah, I said it. I said it. I did it. I can handle that. I have white privilege. I have a very charismatic white privilege.
Sure. And having that privilege means that you don't have to deal with things like being racially profiled or getting unfairly turned down for a mortgage loan because of your skin color or being a minority at your workplace. So you have to explain privilege to people you work with.
That's terrible. Have those things ever happened to you?
Yeah. One of them is happening right now.
Oh my God. Oh God, did you just get turned down for a mortgage loan?
No, I'm explaining privilege to someone I work with.
I'm the worst. Oh, I am so stupid.
Okay.
I'm the problem.
No, James, no,
I'm
it's
the
okay.
problem. I'm
that's
the problem.
Why,
oh
that's
God.
Why we're doing this. Don't. It's okay, because there's so many helpful things that you can do with your privilege.
But like what?
Recognizing it is a huge step. And now that you recognized it, you can use it to fight for a more just society.
I can?
Yes, you can use your privilege to speak up on behalf of people of color in big ways and small ways. Big ways like fighting for social justice in areas like education, healthcare, and housing, and smaller ways like listening to people of color, especially when we talk about racism, without making it about your feelings.
Oh my God, making it about my feelings. That's what I just did. Well, now that's made me feel absolutely. Never mind.
There you go. This has been 3 things you can do to help.
Sylvia Howard, everybody, we'll be right.
Okay. I want to work for James Corden.
That was interesting. Amanda, you know, when I found, of course, it's hard topics are always better when laced with humor, right? So.
Yeah. Well, it is a big topic. It's a difficult topic. Some of you might have seen my posts earlier that I was nervous about this one. I was feeling a lot of anxiety. And so I thought it would be really important to once again reiterate that we're not experts. We're just here to have the conversation. And so we had to go out and find experts. And so we've invited 2 experts to our panel today to really help us unpack this and understand it. So Melissa's going to bring them into the broadcast while I introduce them. First up, I am so honored that Dr. Jacqueline Badalora agreed to come to our broadcast today. She's got so much to share. I did spend a good part of today stalking her videos and honestly learning a lot about American history. Dr. Jacqueline Badalora is a keynote speaker, author, trainer, and consultant in the workplace on educational inclusion. Her keynotes about legal invention of the human category, white people. Yes, it was invented. Have really turned our contemporary feelings upside down and made us rethink and reorient how we feel about race in America. Dr. Badalora is the author of Birth of a White Nation, The Invention of White People and Its Relevance Today, in numerous articles. She's an attorney and professor of sociology at St. Xavier University. She's a former Chicago police officer. I think that's very amazing and badass. Dr. Badalora is the editor of the Journal of Understanding and Dismantling Privilege. Mm-hmm. Our topic today, she completed her law degree from the University of Toledo and came to Chicago to practice. Her interest in the role of law in creating human difference shaped her graduate work at Northwestern University, where she received her PhD. Welcome to the show, Dr. Badalora.
Thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. So next up, we also have joining our panel tonight from the economic side of the conversation. We're very intentional in framing our talk tonight about Black, white, and the color green, because the truth is that there is a systemic impact that racism has as a result of white privilege. Eric Woodson definitely adds color, light, and his own perspective to this side of the conversation. Eric is the CEO and founder of The Cool Source, an integrated marketing agency out of Atlanta, Georgia. He's essentially a quintessential guy to a lot of people in business, top executives in our industry, developers, and owners. He's a lifelong purveyor, serial entrepreneur, professional in all rights, where he gives wise counsel to several inside and outside of our industry. He's found his zenith as a master strategist, and I've seen it at work, and it's pretty amazing to see. Within the Cool Source serves over 100,000 units in multifamily real estate, but we also serve clients outside of the industry. And beyond leading the way in digital, quite honestly, he's just passionate about community, about advocacy, economics, and increasing economic empowerment in the Black community. So I not only call him friend, he's also my boss, but I promise you, these conversations in our workplace have been tremendously enlightening. It makes it fun and more interesting to come to work to not only learn, but feel heard. So welcome Eric Woodson to the conversation.
Well, thank you. You know, guys, I threatened Melissa to make sure she made me sound really cool. So thank you for that. That was an amazing introduction, especially after coming after, Dr. Badalora, you know. That was great. Thank you, Melissa. Thank you, ladies, for having me.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, our topic tonight, white privilege, you know, when I was exploring this and talking to other people about it, I heard a lot of opinion that, hey, we all have something, you know, my life wasn't easy either. I didn't have an opportunity to go to college. I worked my way up. There was a lot of pushback and on this topic, and I was sensing a little bit of fear and apprehension. I know I had some anxiety about it. And so I really want to invite Dr. Badalora to kind of define white privilege for our audience. How would you define it?
Well, I understand white privilege to be the automatic concurrence of advantage by virtue of being seen as white in a society that presumes that white people are the ideal, and that presumption has historically been built into laws. And then in the contemporary moment, it is reflected in policies and practices.
So I think one of the things that we find white people push back on is that they don't want to feel guilty for being white. And one of the things that I've learned by following you and learning from you is that it's not just that we're white, it's the laws in our society, it's the way our society is structured. Can you give us a little bit of background on how that impacts the world today?
Absolutely. Here's the truth of the matter is that none of us are to blame for this structured society that we live in. And I can give us some concrete examples of that. But I would like to first quote Tim Wise, who says, "Whiteness has been done to all of us," which doesn't mean the effect of it is the same, right? For persons of African, indigenous descent, and other people of color, the results are often extremely tragic and can be life-threatening. For white people, whiteness
we still aren't responsible for it in this moment, but we are responsible for continuing it and affirming it in our present moment. And I know it later in the show, we'll get to some of that. But let me just give some examples of white privilege, okay? All right, y'all. We white people, some are poor, some are not Christian, living in a Christian nation. But I'll cite one law that I think provides a nice example of what white privilege looks like. And if y'all will allow me to become professor for a minute, what I'd like to do is explain what whiteness is, because it's directly connected to white privilege. Okay, whiteness is a concept. For those of y'all who hated theory, you're going to have to suffer with me for a second. So the concept of whiteness was actually developed by the sociologist Ruth Frankenberg in her, I think it was a 1993 publication, White Women, Race Matters. And her conception of whiteness has three components to it. The first is structural advantage for white people. I'll give you a concrete example of it in a second, but I'm just going to lay out the theories. Structural advantage for white people that shaped viewpoints white people have of ourselves, others, and the world. And then finally, social norms that developed as a result of the prior two. So these are the three components that work dynamically to then create white privilege. And let me just make it concrete, okay? The founders of our country had to, in 1789 and 1790, they were tasked with coming up with all the laws of our brand new nation called the United States of America, including laws concerning immigration and naturalization. Remember that naturalization is the legal process that one must follow when you're not born in a country and you seek to become a citizen, all right? So naturalization, our founders determined that in order to naturalize a US citizen, you had to be white, okay? So poor people and most of the immigrants who came here were poor, they got access to citizenship. Jewish people, other non-Christian groups got access to citizenship if they were viewed as white. And whether you asked for it or not, whether you wanted it or not, it was baked into the law. And so that's just one example, but let me also help you to realize that that requirement of being white to naturalize lasted 150 years. 150 years you had to be white. So our founders privileged being white from the moment our country formed over how much knowledge you had, over the skills that you possessed, over your love of liberty and justice and all of the other ideals we claim to hold as essential to this nation. White was privileged above it all.
What changed that law?
1952 changed that law, and really it was the result of post-World War II when we went and fought fascism and Nazism, and then we had to come home to our own country and face our own eugenics. We started eugenics laws. The state of Indiana actually had the first one in the world way before Hitler rose to power. This country was practicing eugenics.
And then wow. I want to add in there, 1952 wasn't that long ago.
Right.
I was born in 1973. So right. To think, and Dr. Battalore, you don't know this, but I'm married to an African-American man. And we had this conversation recently. It wasn't that long ago that it was completely legal in every state to even marry who I'm married to.
So, 1969, Loving versus Virginia, that got changed. But then Mississippi wouldn't comply anyway. Yeah,
Mississippi.
And so here's what whiteness, when I say the word whiteness, I hope people can remember structural advantage plus white viewpoint. So let's take that one law, right? The naturalization law that required you be white. What are the viewpoints for white people that one law worked to shape? right? That this country's for us. It created a viewpoint of the world that this country is for us. And then the social norm that those two work together to construct is one that is still with us today, y'all. The equation of white equals American. And let me give you an example of how that equation is still with us. We preserve it in our linguistic practices. Some of our people on this call are African Americans. Other viewers may be Latinx Americans, Pacific Island Americans, Asian Americans. But the other three of us here, even if our family came to this country last week and we speak English, we're just American. Right? And so is it my fault that that law's in place, that that viewpoint was perpetuated, that that social norm preexisted? No, it's not my fault. But I live in that same society, that society shaped by it. And I've been conferred advantages as a result of it, not the least of which is that regardless of where I'm from, I'm seen as American. And I get the advantages conferred. And that, y'all, that is one law. We could talk about thousands of them. Because the year after the whiteness was then removed, we passed the Housing Act, right? The huge Housing Act passed. And we know that the Housing Act required that money to build houses for white people could only be, they required that the developments be white only. And they did make a little bit of money available for housing for people of color, but the amount of money by law given for houses for white people versus houses for non-white people, a lot more was given per house for white people. And so the kinds of racial divides that we're going to, economic divides that we still see growing today, separating wealth between white people and non-white people, it hasn't ended just because that law ended. It continues because appreciation, and then you have wealth that gets passed down through estate planning. We never made reparations. We treated it like, oh, the law's gone. What are you people whining about, right? But that's insane. We've continued those economic harms up to this very present moment. And then the unearned advantage of them, I still am conferred today, 2020.
Wow. That's a lot.
Well, you just opened the can right there.
No, I think we're all sitting back. I feel like I'm in class and I have so many notes here.
Yes.
Because it's you gave us a very quick history lesson on the laws that are still on the books today, and even some that, although eradicated, have deeply steep impact on the economy. And then I'm so thankful you touched on particularly our industry and the housing industry and that effect. I've had a lot of conversations about seeing this displayed or educating us in the media. And a really good movie that I saw recently and discussed with friends is The Banker with Samuel Jackson. And it deals with redlining not only across the country, it talks specifically, it's based on a true story. I think it's important to understand that even today, and I've seen articles about that, is how it's built into our system, the algorithm of it. When Patrick Moran was on, he talked about like the digital divide of how it's built into algorithms of systems, whether it's loan approvals and whatever, it's a whole number of things. How can we educate ourselves, Dr. Battalore? Like, are there resources, whether on your site? I mean, you have a whole library of videos. How can we know better?
Oh my goodness. There is so much. I don't know if people read anymore, but particularly those in your field of real estate, this book called The Color of Law, Richard Rothstein, it's a must read for y'all. You just have to read it. You have to know it. It's the history of the laws that have created wealth gap through housing policy and law. So it's a requirement for y'all. And I think because real estate is so connected with our education system in this country. The other book, aside from my book, of course, everyone should read my book, Birth of a White Nation. the other book that's a must read is called White Rage by Carol Anderson, because what it does is Dr. Anderson covers the all of the policies and practices that have gone into place since Brown versus Board of Education to ensure that the promises of that legal decision would never be fulfilled. Example after example after example. I mean, it's heartbreaking, but it's important, so important for us to know about. So those are at least two books. There's it is escaping my brain at the moment. Oh, Race the Power of an Illusion is a documentary series from a group out of California. Oftentimes libraries will allow you to stream it. I highly recommend it. They have one on redlining that's terrific. They also have one for people who think race is about melanin and genetics and biology. They have one of the first ones completely dispels that you'll see that race has nothing to do with genetics. So it's really helpful for people. You know what? Can I just say one more outrageous thing to your viewers? Yeah. If you don't have 700 hits by now, we'll work on getting them for you.
Okay. No, these comments are rolling in. Everyone needs to hear this because it's more than just a conversation. People really thirst to be educated on this because it's the blinders are coming off that it's been around us the entire time. So yes, please keep sharing. And we'd like to hear it.
Yeah, I'd like to make just a couple other points. And it's a lot harder than for those who were already feeling challenged by the claim that we have white privilege. I have something even worse to say to you. And that is this, that white privilege is the result, but systemic white supremacy is the cause. We wouldn't have the privileges that we have as white people, but for the fact that our institutions are built upon a foundation that presumes white people are superior.
Well, you certainly brought that to today's topic. And what's going on in America right now?
Yeah.
That's a good connection.
It's not your fault. It's not your fault. If I could share one thing for anybody who was feeling that kind of defensiveness and the push away, wanting to push away from white privilege, from owning that, I mean, I get it. I don't know anybody who doesn't. But if you really understand our history, and you don't have to be a history buff, you just have to know enough to realize that it's been done to us. I begin my classes with, I'm racist. How can I not be? I was born into this nation set up that taught me from the moment of my birth that white people are better. I learned it through the dolls I got. I learned it through Barbie. I learned it through every show that I watched. I learned it through the curriculum I was taught, where Columbus was a discoverer and wonderful and amazing, even though he raped and pillaged and stole and colonized, was part of colonization. And so when you realize that it's so much bigger than us and that it's been done to us, if you can just breathe in, I was born into a racist system. And the only way I could have escaped all of this white supremacy in all these institutions, including just basic education, I would have to live in a bubble protected from all of this imagery and all of these messages. And we're not. All of us wouldn't be here if we were in that bubble. So I have to own that I'm racist. And frankly, it at least for me, and I hear this from my students and people who I have a chance to work with over time, people in my own, I'll use an I statement. I know that for me, it melts away all that defensiveness because I don't have to defend against it. And then if I can actually just be in it and be accepting, not okay with, mind you, but accepting of the fact that this is the society I was born into and that I find myself in the moment, then I can I'm not defending against you, Melissa, when you want to tell me, hey, Jackie, you know, you said something and the way you said that, it was really offensive in this, you know, X, Y, and Z. Or that assumption, you just made an assumption about me. And when you say, yeah, you speak really well, that's really offensive in these ways, right? And so I can hear it because I'm not defending against. And here's the best part, y'all. The best part of this from my white self is that it has allowed for genuine, loving relationships with people of color. Relationships that were not at all possible before when I was defending against, you know, I'm not racist. I'm defending against, you know, I don't have white privilege. So it's a much better place to be. I highly recommend it.
Wow. I can't say how much I appreciate the way you framed that in terms of how to lovingly listen and empathize. So many nuggets given. I want to take a step back to what you said about the systemic impact and the economics. And then even when we discuss the identifiers of nationality of being, you know, Italian American or what, like just, or African American, Latinx American. And so Eric and I had a very interesting dialogue and I want to insert some of his thoughts. And even what he shared with me, you know, even though our commonality on advocacy for our people, but then having some of the geographical differences of how we were raised. I was born and raised in the South in Birmingham, Alabama. He was born and raised in New York. Eric, you want to share a little bit of your perspective, what you shared of seeing growing up in New York and the racial differences in nationality?
You're muted.
There you go. I unmuted him.
There we go. Wow, which one? What were we talking about today? What were we talking about last month?
Because it was very interesting. You talked about your perspective of race growing up in New York and how it was more of a community sense of, hey, you had Italian Americans, Irish Americans, and different things like that. And how that, yeah, so it's your perspective was very, I never thought about it that way, being from the South.
Correct. I grew up in Staten Island, New York. I don't know if any of you guys have recently watched the Dave Chappelle special, but he said Staten Island was an awful place, you know, and I tend to, you know, agree with him, even though I'm from there. You know, I loved my childhood growing up, but Staten Island was very segregated. You had the North Shore, you had the South Shore, and you had stuff in between, but it was very diced up by, you know, not just race, but by economics. You know, the North Shore where I grew up, it was, you know, lined with housing projects, you know, all the way essentially down one or two streets. It was just nothing but, you know, housing projects. While, you know, we, where I grew up, it was, you know, we had a few white families, but it was predominantly Black and Hispanic, but really predominantly Black. The school I went to, 90% white. All the activities in the area, you know, it was just, everything was just diced up. And I shared with Melissa, one of the great things that my mom did for me, and I don't know if I believe she did this conscious because I heard her on several occasions arguing with other parents. She would put me in activities outside of my neighborhood that forced me to, you know, make friendships with, you know, Italian kids, with Jewish kids, with Asian kids. So I grew up and I had friends from all different backgrounds. And I also shared with Melissa, I learned business from, the two people I learned business from were, it was an Italian man who owned a mechanic shop and a Jewish man who owned multiple Exxon gas stations. Those were my like early mentors when I was, you know, 12, 13 years old. That was my first taste of entrepreneurship. And, you know, they took a liking to me because I asked tons of questions. You know, they taught me how to shake hands and tie a proper tie and talk the talk and walk the walk. And, you know, my dad was around, but he, you know, he worked for the housing authority. He didn't notice stuff. But it was, yeah, growing up, it was very segregated. But, you know, my mom just made it a point to make sure I had different perspectives growing up.
Eric, if I could ask you a question, when you were listening to Dr. Badalora and hearing about the history and the how our country was essentially founded on these white laws, how were you feeling? How did that make you feel?
I was taking notes. I got my notebook. I was in class. So I don't know if you saw me with my head down. I was,
I don't think there's a test at the end, by the way.
Something that I don't know. Yeah. So, it was like preach, you know what I mean? And she was very, forthcoming and straightforward. And these are things I've not only learned, but experienced my entire life. That you just kind of have to deal with, you know what I mean? It's just like a subconscious thing. Like, I don't think about it every day. I don't think about it most days. It's just life, mm-hmm. You know, just how you wake up and brush your teeth and wash your face. It's, hey, I'm a black dude. And, you know, even though I'm on as far as economics go, I'm on a higher scale. I know driving home tonight, that could change in an instant.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. You know? Where I have to teach my son, like, dude, you can't, you know, he's getting a little height on him, his shoulders are getting a little wide, that voice is getting deep, like, you're not the cute little boy no more. You're 11, going on 12, you know, somebody might be scared of you. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to watch yourself, you have to protect yourself. So, yeah, everything she was saying, that's life. That's what it is.
You know, Dr. Badalora, Eric bringing up the harsh reality of many Black parents when looking at their sons in particular, sons and daughters, but I do say sons in particular because there is this point when they're not the cute kid running around the neighborhood anymore. And can you explain whiteness or that lens of how does that happen, I guess, from a psychological standpoint where that the image of that child now changes in that community?
Yeah, I don't know the psychology. I can reference as a sociologist what we know happens in schools, mm-hmm. But it's less an explanation than it is, a furtherance of what you're saying, right? Because we know that when you look at how teachers respond to children's behavior in the classroom, white children engaged in the same behavior being performed by principally African-American boys in a classroom or girls, the teachers experience the behavior being committed by a boy or girl of African descent as if it is aggression, whereas the same behavior being enacted by white children just gets interpreted completely differently out of an innocence, out of, he's got a lot of energy. She's enthusiastic, right? So a whole completely different framework. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, one of the things that I do in my trainings that I hope it will be useful for us. So here's one thing that I do. I call it a mirror exercise. So I have people tell me, and here's the key, because lots of y'all want to go to what you believe. And I don't give a damn what you believe right now. I'm asking you to reflect society, okay? So that's the rule. It's not about what you believe. It's about what society taught you. And usually I have people kind of reflect on their childhood stuff, you know, like your neighborhood, where you lived, who you played with, picture books that you, earliest picture books, toys that you played with, those who were your friends at school. So once you have that in mind, I flash in front of people, let's say black male. You have 15 seconds to tell me everything your society taught you about black men. And so it's short, 15 seconds goes really fast because I want to get the most pervasive messages from people. And I'm going to use the two extremes in my example with y'all, but I use lots of things. Indigenous female, indigenous male, Pacific Island, and nobody ever has anything to say. Pacific Island, did we learn that? Do those people exist? Right, so I'm gonna use the two examples that are the extreme for our purposes. So the other one is a white male. And I have data from thousands of adults having done these exercises. And so the top three, if I can remember them off the top of my head, well, the number one message that we have learned, according to thousands of adults, is that Black men are dangerous. Number one. Second is uneducated. Third is good athlete. Though, y'all, that means those messages are our default setting. Like, drink that in. That is our default setting. Now, switch to the white man. What are the top three for white men? Educated, wealthy, privileged. I think those are the top three. I know educated's number one. Powerful. It's educated, powerful, privileged. So again, that shapes our default settings. Now, I don't want to, I'm worried I'm depressing everyone. Look, we don't have to stay there. We do not have to stay there. But here's the thing. Those default settings, that childhood stuff that we learned, I mean, think about it. People who don't do their therapy work as adults, we end up just enacting out of our childhood nonsense for the rest of our lives. And that is no less true for this race stuff that we learned. So that means that if we're going to get in a different place, if we're going to change our default setting so that I can approach Eric with human dignity, allow him to speak for himself rather than that grouping of messages define him, then I can do it. But it takes tremendous effort. It takes intentionality. It takes making sure that I am intentionally putting images in front of myself that completely contest those images. It means that I'm developing relationships with persons of color, African-American men in this case in particular, that are constantly challenging that default setting. And eventually you don't need that stuff anymore because you're just changed. But it takes a lot of work and it doesn't happen. I like to think of confronting whiteness, especially as white people, like working out. Like, how great if I could read one book and be fit, woohoo, right? Doesn't work that way, right? It takes work, it takes effort. Sometimes we need people, right? I could call Kate and say, you know, let's go start doing walking teams together. And so we need all of that kind of effort to be successful changing this, but we can change it. We were born into a system of white supremacy, but it does not have to be here when we leave. It doesn't.
That process that you just took us through, the mirror, thank you. That was very powerful. And I was drinking it in, but also watching my good friend Amanda.
Yeah.
I was moved by it because I think I know what was going through her mind. She doesn't want that for her son.
Of course.
Her son Zeke. How old is Zeke?
He's 12.
He's 12. So he's really coming into.
I keep getting texts to tell me to stop crying.
It's okay. Okay.
It's hard because when you're preparing a young man and so I think Eric just said, somebody just said his son is growing tall. Mm-hmm. And when does he move from a boy to a man? Mm-hmm. And then.
Yeah.
How do you train them for that?
Yeah.
You can't. You can't. You know, you can coach them up all you want, you know, but it until that happens, you know, until the first time the police has you up against the car, you know, I remember my first time and it's like, you know, all the things that, you know, my parents told me, they just became real and you just, like, what the hell is going on? And I did nothing. You know what I mean? I did nothing. And for, you know, I remember the day I was coming home from football practice. It was a bunch of us. We were getting off the bus and, you know, they rounded us up and threw us against the wall. We had, well, what do you have on you? Where are you coming from? Like, idiot, you see we have you know, football equipment. We're holding helmets. What are you talking about? You know, like they made one of my friends like strip on the street.
You know, like, Dr. Badalora, one of the things that you were talking about that exercise, which is a difficult exercise to hear, especially if you're raising a child of color. But I had the conversation this week with somebody who I was describing how people describe me as a strong, assertive woman who, you know, has worked really hard to get where I'm at. I say what I think, I stand up for what I think is right. And I hear those same comments about my female friends that are African-American and they're angry Black women. Yeah. And mm-hmm. I'm like, we have the exact same characteristics. What mm-hmm. you are complimenting me for is right. exactly what she is.
Right.
And it's labeled completely different.
That's right. Mm. That's right.
So then my question, I want to pitch this to Amanda and Kate. And Amanda, I so appreciate you shedding light on that as a Black woman. You know, just you really kind of started, you went segued into that of what you thought about all of this or your own experiences and what Dr. Badalora said. How does this, I guess, personally pierce and evoke you to take action? Because you guys are really being a compass here. You've been so transparent as white women to avail yourself and say, hey, I want to learn. What are the things that you personally decided to shine a lens on and change for yourselves, if you don't mind sharing that?
I'll go ahead. Kate, I'll let you think about it. first of all, I feel like I've learned more history in this not even hour yet than I ever did in school. And I'll tell you, I grew up south of Indianapolis in a not a very diverse city. And we started Black history and 2 days in, our history teacher was stopped. So I feel that my responsibility, and I'm raising my son with my husband who is African-American, but we talked about what did he learn in school? And oddly enough, city of Indianapolis, he didn't learn a lot either. And I yeah. think my number one goal first is to educate myself so I can educate my son. Yeah. You know, we also have two daughters that are 26 and 24. Mm-hmm. And I feel like we need to educate and work with them as well, mm-hmm. but they're going to do that on their own, I assume. But I have to understand where a lot of this comes from. So I can teach him. I don't understand it. I wasn't taught. I mean, we'd had this discussion last week. I didn't even know what Juneteenth was until this year. And I feel really guilty about it. But the way you described it and the way you talked about it earlier is now I see why I wasn't taught, because our system doesn't allow us to be taught those things.
That's good. Kane?
Well, really what I keep feeling within myself right now is I grew up in a very white town in Ohio, the heart of it all, they like to say. And we didn't have any exposure, but I take myself back to that childhood, that little girl, and all I wanted to do was get out. You know, all I wanted to do was go see the world. I couldn't wait to get my passport. Most kids, when they're 16 years old, they want a car. I wanted a checkbook. You know, I just couldn't wait to go and start my life. And in my early 20s is when I started in high school, I traveled to the South Pacific on the Junior Olympic track team. And that was really one of the first times that I saw nations that were predominantly Black. And I saw, you know, great societies that were predominantly Black. And I didn't have any exposure to it. And I really didn't even understand what I was seeing, but I knew it was very different than where I came from. And then in my 20s, then I started to choose my destinations and traveling the world. And, you know, now I'm 51 and I've been to 29 countries. And wow. I always have said something that now I don't know how I feel about what I always said. I always said, I love coming home to America. I still feel, I feel very privileged that this is the country that I was born into as a woman. I always felt that we had a great society, and now I'm kind of mad at it. Now, you know, and now I'm kind of, and I knew we had problems. Don't get me wrong. I wasn't walking around with my head in the clouds. I knew we had problems, and I knew we had issues. But what I didn't really understand is that the very basis and foundation of American society was that it privileged white people. It created a privileged environment for white people. Yep. And I do want to see that change, because that's not the America that I want to be proud of. And it's not, and I don't really think it represents, it should represent America today, because we are a country of a lot of different races and ethnicities and immigrants. I come from an immigrant family myself. We are Italian Americans. And that was always something that, you know, I was really proud of, because I knew why my family came to this country, and I knew what it meant to them to come to this country. And I wish all people, you know, to have that opportunity and privilege that my family had.
Yeah. I think, you know, given what you said about the exposure and the impact that gave you, I want to just take a second to look at our next video here that further explains now the economic side of it, right? Because there's some economics that plays into that travel and exposure and awareness. Eric and I've had conversations about that what despite economics, not if you have the means to do it, like he said, his mom was very intentional. Like, hey, we may not have traveled the world, but we can travel across town for you to have some cross-cultural experiences. And I think that's very important. So I want to frame the next part of our conversation about economics by sharing the video we selected, specifically about an intro to the wealth gap. And I think this is an excellent bridge to what Dr. Badalora said about the systemic impact. So let's take a look at that.
Just over 150 years ago, this was money for almost half of America. On multiple bills were people picking cotton, enslaved people. These slaves didn't just represent wealth in America, they were wealth. By 1863, they were worth over $3 billion. Since then, America has slowly, painfully transformed as a country, breaking down racial barrier after racial barrier.
I am very optimistic about the future. Frankly, I have seen certain changes in the United States that surprised me. So on the basis of this, I think we may be able to get a Negro president in less than 40 years. I would think in 25 years or less.
Wealth is different.
Wealth is where past injustices breed present suffering.
I think the racial wealth gap speaks to the fact that we still have a long way to go to achieve ideals of equality in this country.
The racial wealth gap is a measure of the white family and the African American family that's right smack dab in the middle, the median.
The median white household's wealth, their savings, assets, minus their debts, is $171,000. The median black household's is $17,600. And that gap is still growing and growing. Why?
We hold these truths to be self-evident.
Now we have the right to go to inner school in America, but we can't pay the tuition.
I wake up every morning in a house that was built by slaves.
The American dream need not forever be deferred.
That all men are created equal.
If they can't have their equal share in the house, they'll burn it down.
I picked the cotton, and I built the railroad under someone else's whip for nothing.
So we're just playing the first couple minutes of that. I encourage you to watch all of that. It's about a 17-minute Netflix documentary about exactly this. Economics, the disparity between wealth and wages. It was really informative. So between Dr. Batalora and Netflix, I'm like going to get a master's degree soon. let's hop into this because I think that is just a small snippet of how you can't start the race if you're 300 years behind the starting line.
Mm-hmm. You know, what stood out to me, and I want to pitch this to Eric, there was a quote at the beginning of that clip that said, wealth is where past injustices breed present day sufferings. Yeah. So for you as a Black man growing up where you're from in New York, being where you are today as an agency owner, serial entrepreneur, what are your thoughts, or I guess what's your lens on the economic impact of systemic racism?
I mean, it is profound. But again, as I said earlier, I don't, you know, you don't wake up thinking about it. It's just something that is, that's there. You know, I got into a, you know, minor argument with my son. You know, he said, Dad, you talk about money a lot. Money isn't everything. And I said, no, you're correct, but it's a whole lot, you know, especially when the Black community's generations behind in wealth, tech, ownership, you know, we're so far behind, and that is the one thing that has, for me, provided me access, my wealth and my education. From that, I've been able to get access. So, you know, I'm trying to drill in his head, and, you know, friends of mine, like, that is one of the ways to kind of even this out a little bit, close that wealth gap. So, you know, from picking majors when you're going to college, like, hey, if you want to go to be a teacher, you may not want to go to Harvard because that's a $50,000-$60,000 a year education. You might want to go to the state school so you're not burdened with those loans. You know, we have to think smarter about what we do and how we do it to close that wealth gap. And oftentimes, you know, my parents didn't teach me much about money because they didn't know. You know, they just said, don't use credit cards. You know what I mean? I did anyway, but, you know, but that's what it was. And we have to teach our children in order to close that gap to, I mean, like you said, we're so far behind.
One of the things that I thought is interesting is many times because white people started so far ahead, our parents, our grandparents, and even before that, were able to build their wealth and they pass it down, right? So we may not, I'm not a trust fund child or anything like that, but my grandparents had a nice life. When they passed away, that stuff was passed to my mom and my aunt. And we have those legacies ahead of us. But when African Americans start out so far behind, and like Eric said, you know, his parents didn't talk a lot about money because it probably, you know, wasn't generational and passed down to him. You're just trying to make ends meet, right?
Correct.
And so there's a long generational wealth gap as well, because as white people, we're almost, and not everybody, but there's generational wealth that's passed. Mm-hmm. But when you're building it from the ground up, it's not there to pass.
You know, I
no, and those are the effects of slavery. We didn't have, you know, when slaves were free, you were free, but what? So, oh, you're free now. What do you have? Right? You didn't get that 40 acres and a mule. You got nothing. You got, you know, a different form of slavery, right? You were indentured servants, essentially working the land of your former slave owners. You know, then when you do get ahead, you have, you know, situations like, you know, what happened in Tulsa, Oklahoma, Black Wall Street, where you have a thriving community and it gets burned down for what? You know, we had our own hospitals, movie theaters, banks, things like that. We were living a separate life and thriving, but for whatever reason, you know, we understand and know what the reason is, that was taken away. And that wasn't the only neighborhood that happened in, you know, the race riots in 1906 in Atlanta, same thing. So every step in the way, you know, GI Bill, you know, when a lot of veterans were able to get home loans, you know, Black veterans weren't able to get those. because the banks weren't lending in African-American neighborhoods. So all of these things were put into place to make it difficult for us. Mm-hmm. And we weren't able to take advantage of these opportunities.
So Eric, I want to put you the question that's on the screen here from Kathy. She says, how do you help whites who think they still struggle financially understand the impact of race disparity?
I don't.
No, but there is something you do that I've observed. I talked about that when walking into rooms where, again, green is the kind of the common denominator here. It's like, hey, you might see black and white, but there's some quality when we come to the table when it comes to green.
Correct. But I can't say that I think the question was what? How do you help whites who think they still struggle? I mean, as far as helping, I don't think I do that, but I do believe, yes, there is some, economic inequality when it comes to green. I'm able to get access to rooms and to people because of my financial stature. People listen to me because they deem me successful. So, hey, this dude knows what he's doing, so maybe he can help me. But as far as, helping whites, I don't. I mean, I'm trying to help myself and my family. So no.
What about Dr. Badalora?
I'm glad you said. I mean, and I'm glad we can say it with humor, but in all seriousness, that's some of the struggle is blacks trying to help whites understand, and that's really the value in having Dr. Badalora in this conversation. It's like, as blacks, how do I educate you if I can't get through to you, or if I'm not received in the right way? When Dr. Badalora put it so eloquently, like owning your part of that conversation. When you talk about the economics of it, Jacora actually made a really good point. She said part of the problem is that black people were never taught the art of business. So Amanda, interestingly enough, you said, hey, I was never taught these things about our country. Well, there's so much miseducation, right? There's a white miseducation on the history of this country. It's a black miseducation about economic access and value. So it's a lot of miseducation going on.
Yeah. Dr. Badalora, I think our dogs need to meet each other. They both want to be on this broadcast. Yeah,
sorry about that.
No problem at all. Not around here. We're all dog lovers.
I wanted to say a thousand things. Like, it's just a reminder that we're just going to do so little in this conversation, but it's still so important to do this. And so, Melissa, I guess I did want to say one thing, and that is, I mean, it's white people's job to be teaching white people. Like, people of color have enough extra work to do confronting whiteness. And so, send them to me. And there's lots of other people, trying to be anti-racists. And it's our job to be teaching us.
Yeah.
I agree. And can I say one thing? I will say what this time has brought about, many of my friends in the industry, it has helped open up, and thank you, ladies, but it's helped open up a dialogue. So I get so many texts on a regular basis. Hey, Eric, can I run this by you? Or can I ask you about this? Tell people, you don't have to preface it by saying, please don't take this the wrong way. Just ask me. If you're a friend of mine, just ask the question. And, I know where it's coming from. You know what I mean? There's no need to preface it with anything. But that is the great thing that has come from this time. These conversations that we weren't having in the past, we are having now. So hopefully, there is, even if it's a little change, I'll take it.
Yeah. Absolutely. And you know what? To white people, it's important to remember, like, we're going to mess up. I'm going to say something that's reveals a racial bias that is racist, and it doesn't mean it's okay, but I'm gonna do it because I'm a product of this culture and society. And so I just did one recently, somebody I just adore, and I totally offended them, and I didn't understand how I was playing into whiteness, and so I've just asked if he'll allow me to apologize and do what I can to make amends and move on. I'm not going to stay mired in it. And I definitely messed up. I mess up with some regularity, and I can take responsibility for it and apologize. And, you know, lots of white women kind of stay in that, and we feel like we get caught in being, thinking we're bad and feeling guilty. And, you know, we've just got to keep growing. It's part of growing. We make mistakes. Think of our kids. If they never made a mistake, what would you have learned? You know, part of that is how we grow. And and I also would like to say this, that some of the people who I've made those kinds of mistakes with, people of color, and I've had the chance to apologize and make amends and then grow, we're closer than ever, you know, because you can say sorry and mean it and grow together.
Mm-hmm. You know, Dr. Battalora, I want to touch on that. One of, you know, we've had so many deep, open, candid conversations between Kate, Amanda, and I as we prepare for this every week. And it is spread out into all of my other dialogue. But I can truly say the beauty of this whole process is when we're vulnerable enough to say, I don't know. That is actually the bravest thing you can ever do, is tell someone, I don't know, and I messed up, and I'm sorry. And, you know, even among us, like I said, when we come to each other, come in love. You referenced love earlier, that, okay, if I spend time with these women, if we work together, if I spend time with my colleagues, my peers, my coworkers, that's why I'm such an advocate for having these conversations at your job. We spend more time with our colleagues and contemporaries than our own family. So no, if you work together that much and you can't trust each other and come in love, you have a bigger problem. That's the basis of the conversation here. You have to trust that, hey, I believe that you did not intend to offend, and you may be ignorant to the fact of your offense. So can you receive my truth? And then can I trust that you can come back to me in love and correct it, right? So I think that's very important, that we build relationships of trust, that we spend the lunch break asking questions, asking about how they grew up. You know, I learned something new about Kate today. I didn't know about her upbringing in Ohio. That gives me some frame of reference when I spend time in conversation with her. Mm-hmm. Understanding Amanda's fears about her son gives me empathy for her as I would for any other Black mother and their son. She has a commonality in that. Understanding Eric and his upbringing, the unique thing in my situation is that we have these conversations all the time in my workspace, but it's the first time in 16 years of my career where I've been safe enough to do it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
So how, as leaders, are we creating safe spaces of radical candor? Do your people trust you with their truth?
Right. Yeah. Well, that's where leadership comes in. And I feel like this historic moment that we're living in is a chance for the best leaders to really shine. I can't tell you how many messages I've received from, especially school principals, but other educational and corporate leaders who tell me, oh yeah, you know, well, we're really hoping that the parents will start a reading group or something like this. And I just want to scream back at them, you know, if you could count on that, we wouldn't be here. Mm-hmm. You know, like, no, we have got to do more. Create the incentive, right? Like, think about your kids. When my kids started school, like, I was so terrified for her, and I would have done anything to have a little connect in with her teacher, right? Use the teachers. We parents want to be buds with the teachers. Like, use what you can to create incentives so that we as parents will recognize our own whiteness, our own relationship to it, our lack of information or knowledge of history. Because the one thing everybody should leave this show with is we need to go to our school boards and say, enough of these lies. We are telling lies.
Yeah.
That even though we think, okay, the only history we're getting is white history, it isn't even a truthful white history. Like, we don't even do that right. So but we're paying the taxes, you know? They will respond to us if we build build the voice. And we need an honest reckoning with our country's history. And here's the crazy thing is I share my lectures sometimes with, I'm brought in to talk to seventh and eighth graders. That's about as young as I've done, but the kids are fine. Parents who are traumatized, you know, the kids are fine. And you know, truthfully, the parents would be fine too if they just engaged a few minutes longer than their fear that their poor white child is somehow going to have their ego crushed. You know, they're going to be fine.
Yeah.
They're going to be better than we were because they look, we are sending these kids out there. Go solve violence against people of color in law enforcement. Go solve it. But they don't even know a history to it to give them the tools to do it. Yeah. So we've got to change. We've got to fight for better curriculum, honest curriculum.
Absolutely.
This is an interesting topic. Sorry, Melissa. I talked about my son earlier, and this past year, he's biracial. This past year, he was called a potato all year because he's brown and he has an oval head, right? So kids are cruel. And what has been brought to light over the last month is that this is happening a lot in our particular school district. So we live north of Indianapolis, pretty white area, lots of racial issues. Some stuff has gone viral. And so today of all days, I found out about our group called Westfield Parents for a Change that has this group of almost 800 parents now that are no longer okay with the status quo and how these issues are being handled. And so now it's this major uprising of people, a lot of them being white, who are like, we're not taking this anymore. So I found out about the group today because I was invited by some friends. So I'm super excited. And some of them may be listening because they know about this show. And the superintendent of the school district has now enacted a plan. Mm-hmm. Finally, a plan.
We have a voice. We really do.
Yeah. Parents are so strong. And so if you have one issue, be guaranteed there's a lot of other issues. Come together. And this small group of this school district that I was a little worried about my son starting back at, I think they're going to make a pretty big difference. And the conversations are there. Somebody texted me and said, how do we get Dr. Badalora to come talk to our school district?
Call me.
Yeah. But these are the things that we can't sit by and just say, oh, I'm so upset Zeke's being called a potato. Zeke is one of many children that are probably dealing with these same issues. And it's up to us. My son's not going to say anything. He doesn't want to look like the tattletale or look, you know, weak. So we're gonna change it. So
Amanda, if I can chime in with that. And I think this is a great kind of wrap up, like a final challenge or charge, if you will, to our audience to take action items away from this. I think you and I equally share that passion of education. I know Eric does too, because he's heavily involved in his child's, you know, schooling, the kids in the neighborhood, baseball team, all of those things. And that does make a difference. I think it's not strange. It's not a coincidence that we're in a season where you're having to do, you know, homeschooling and educate your child. I think now is a better time than ever to be very clear about, well, wait, what is it that you were or were not learning? And now you are even more empowered because you have your child within the safety of your care with your education at home. It starts with what you're doing right now. The videos you're putting in front of them, the literature, the lessons, do some virtual museum tours of the African American Museum, the Smithsonian in DC. I mean, there's a wealth and a plethora of resources. So we have no excuse now because our children are at home. I think that's such a radical and dynamic opportunity that we don't want to miss before we send them back out into the world. One of the things that we also, you know, Eric and I talked about, and I've talked to several other leaders and said, hey, look, we adults are a little harder to change. And although we're all doing our part at educating one another, as Dr. Badalora said, hey, white people, it's your time to educate other white people. But children, Gen Z has risen up in a way like we've not seen ever before. They came into the world unapologetic about holding us accountable from birth. So I think there's a great opportunity. So each person, I want to pitch it before we wrap up. What is your one takeaway? That what's the one action you're going to take as a result of tonight's conversations?
All right, Melissa, are you asking the listeners or are you asking us? Because okay. Mine's just further education, like I said earlier.
I want to be more of a student of history and think about the history that children will be studying 50 years from now. And that's what we're doing right now. So I want to look at our history and then I want to shape the future. So when we reflect on this time, it really matters and there's change. I'd like to thank Dr. Badalora. I told her it was going to be an hour, and here we go. I'm sorry, but there's so much quality in this conversation, and you have brought so much to this panel, to our listeners and followers. I'd like to toss it back to you for some final thoughts. What would you like to leave us with?
Well, you know, I'd love to direct people to something called the 21-Day Challenge. It was created by Eddie Moore Jr., Debbie Irving, and one other person, Marguerite Parker. They created it. You can find it online. It's designed especially for white people who say, what do I do? Okay, I understand I have white privilege. It was built in. Now what do I do? And it's a 21-day challenge. I think it's a great, I hope people will make a 21-day commitment because we are all worth it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think, I guess if I could end with one more thing, it would be this, that whiteness, as we began, we noted that it's been done to all of us. And the thing that I think most white people miss, we think that so racial justice is going to be a loss for white people. And here's what that whole way of thinking does. It erases the fact that our humanity has been so damaged by whiteness that if any white person watched what happened to George Floyd and you did not burst into tears, if you could not feel what it would feel like to be that man's parent, or if you're a young person, if you could not see your father have the life squished out of him, if you couldn't feel that, that's whiteness. Whiteness has done that to us, and we need to be healed from that.
Thank you.
We can do it, and we can do it.
We can do it. Wow. Eric,
I mean, it's hard to come after that, you know. But, you know, two things I'll say. You know, we just need to talk to each other, have those conversations and, you know, be open in discussing. And also those of us who have children, you know, yes, bring kids, you know, if you live in an all black or you live in an all white neighborhood, bring them somewhere else to get a more, as Melissa said, a more cross-cultural experience. Mm-hmm. You know, let them, you know, play in the basketball league that's not in your neighborhood. Let them go to dance that's not in your neighborhood and introduce them to, you know, a different group of people. And that's where, it, you know, things start to change with those kids.
Yeah.
Dr. Badalora, I want to be your best friend. Like, yeah. I need you to like come. My sister's been commenting. I need her to come walk with me every day.
Yeah.
I hope this is not the last time. Like, I am so drawn in and there's so much more. You were a police officer and we never even talked about it. So there's so much information and so much insight. And I think that you so eloquently say what we need to hear. We need to hear and we need to learn. Like, again, we don't know everything by far. And that's a lot of weight when you're trying to raise somebody, a child of color, and you have no idea the realities of our country and our systemic issues. You've been amazing. I'm like, yeah, I'm going to cry just because yeah. I feel like I'm in the presence of someone, yeah, like a teacher. So, I do want to mention, we are getting a lot of comments, people that work for school systems.
Yes.
People that work for property management. Are you okay with us sharing your website and your contact information and all of that? Please.
Yeah, the on the webpage is where they'll find my contact information.
Okay.
So go to the webpage. Yeah. It was so nice here. It was so nice to meet you and Melissa. And I thank you all so very much. Thanks, Amanda. Thank you, Kate. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Eric, thank you so much for your contribution and helping us understand how to close the wealth gap. Thank you for that.
Yeah.
No problem. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Everyone have a great night. We're going to follow up. There will be lots of content on the Color Outside the Lines Facebook page because we have links to videos, link to Jacqueline's website, all of that. So tons of information. I appreciate it.
Good night, everybody. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Good night.
Good night.